He was in a sort of succession of kind of weird and wonderful groups. And then he got a job to be the musical director of a kind of music and theatre company called the Sadista Sisters. And he kind of played in the band with the Sadista Sisters and toured Germany.
So there I am in the restaurant, and it's about 10:30 at night, and in walks the most extraordinary looking casualty you've ever seen in your life. And I'm there and I'm like this, sort of transfixed. And they say, "Hi, this is Dave Stewart," you know, and Dave's like, "Hi." And I'm like, "Hi, the manager's over there. Do you want to eat something?" Anyway, this manager was quite a heavy sort of character, and he didn't like the look of them because they looked rather unusual, to say the least. And I said, "Sit down, I'll have a chat with you later." And that was essentially, that was it. That's how I met Dave Stewart. He walked into a restaurant brought in by Paul Jacobs, and I had this contract and da-da-da-da-da. And that's it. That's the story.
I saw through the window of a restaurant, and then, you know, after she finished work, we went to her, she had a tiny little room in Camden Town, and she had a harmonium, a big old harmonium, and she sang and played these very sort of sad kind of songs, and there was something about her immediately that I knew I was going to have to spend a long time with this person.
There was something about her. Do you know what that was?
Well, yeah, it was kind of this, it's kind of like an air of sadness, I think, really. But like a sort of beautiful sadness.
The first time that Dave went properly on tour in his life, he was supporting Elton John with this band called Long Dancer. And he'd really sort of come in like that. And a lot of money had been thrown at this band. And I think a lot of money had gone through down a lot of different places. I don't know where the money went, but it went quickly. And there they were, left high and dry, with no record contract anymore, no money, and all these sort of guys with all this young hopefuls. And they'd been through that experience, you know. And like when I met Dave, he had 2 carrier bags to his name. I remember those 2 plastic bags, and they had all of his belongings in them. So he'd really been sort of churned up and through and out, spat out, so he'd had a lot of experience behind him, you know. The first hit that we had was a cover version of a Dusty Springfield song called For My Sins, For Our Sins. It was called I Only Want to Be With You. And looking back on that, which no doubt you will, I can see all the things that I wished and regret that I hadn't done, because it was so lousy. But nevertheless, you know, one does these things and regrets them deeply.
Dave Stewart's first adventure in the pop world was with Annie Lennox in a group called The Tourists, who actually made no impression whatsoever, because at the time, the late 70s, they were rather staid. I mean, we'd just come out of the explosion of punk and inherited the idea that pop music really ought to be pushing back the frontiers of music as we knew it, and The Tourists really weren't doing that at all. I mean, they had a hit with an old Dusty Springfield song at a time when those sort of cover versions weren't considered terribly fashionable. And although it made a perfectly pleasant noise, and I think it grazed the top 30, if you'd been asked to put money at the end of the 70s, the beginning of the 80s, on who was going to be one of the big bands of the 80s, you would certainly not have put it on a reinvented version of The Tourists.
Eurythmics. Well, I think it stemmed from the fact that when I was a bit younger, when I went to school, there was I had a few classes in a thing called Eurythmy, which was to do with music and movement, or musical expression through movement. And I remembered this term, and I told Dave about this, and we thought it was a very interesting word, because it had this E-U-R at the front and rhythm in the middle, and we rather liked that, you know. E-U-R was kind of Europe and rhythm, and we took the H out because it looked a little bit complicated. And then we told the record company that we wanted to carry on as a duo, and we were very clear about what we wanted to do. It was just like as if the one thing went, and then Dave and I went, yes, let's do this. And it was to be Eurythmics, and we had no doubts about that. And we went and said, this is it. And they went, no, it's not. You're not going to call yourselves that. You can't possibly. You can call yourself Annie Lennox and whatever, and Eurythmics, we said, we're not going to do that. I said, oh, no, here we are, back to this again. But finally, they relented because we said we weren't going to change the name.
I suppose they really got their big break when they kind of made it in America, which was with the album Sweet Dreams. Mm. They'd already begun to do quite well here. I mean, they'd had success with the tourists, you know, they'd had hit singles and things. But when they went to America with the Sweet Dreams album, as they toured across America, the single Sweet Dreams was going up and up and up in the charts, I think to become American number one. And by the time they had travelled across the States from, you know, the East Coast to the West Coast, by the time they were playing the West Coast, they were sort of, you know, the next big thing. I don't think I was jealous of his success. I mean, initially I was just really pleased because I'd kind of seen all of the hard work and effort and, you know, that had gone into it. And this was the third time Dave had kind of had a go at it, and, you know, the second time with Annie. And, you know, you don't often get the chance to do that. I mean, if you're very successful, yes, maybe you can then go off and do other things. But, you know, if you've done it once and been relatively successful and then had another go and been relatively successful, to come back a third time, it's really hard. And on the third time, you know, they'd really kind of cracked it, and I was just really pleased.
You know, I was mainly aware of Dave Stewart through the enormous success of the Eurythmics, who, you know, were one of the most successful British groups of the 1980s. I think they probably sold over 30 million records, something like that. Now, I mean, that's a number that is right up there with anybody huge, you know. I mean, the interesting thing is often people in the modern era outsell people like the Rolling Stones, in a way. You know, there were a time when, you know, people talked about the Doors album selling 500,000 copies in America, their first album. The Eurythmics sold far more than the Doors ever sold.
The Eurythmics really were about Annie Lennox, this, you know, this, as she was perceived, very strong, independent, extremely enigmatic, sort of emotionally quite self-contained, but possibly a bit fragile as well, person. That's really what the Eurythmics were about, and which is unfair on Dave Stewart, because he clearly was the craftsman who actually put together most of their melodies, and was very much in control of the sort of the broader musical direction. But the fact is that Annie Lennox really stole the limelight, because, you know, we mustn't forget the Eurythmics were very much a product of the video age. I mean, their career coincided completely with the rise of MTV and the rise of the pop video, and Annie Lennox was a perfect face for the video age. If video hadn't been invented, I think it's quite possible that the Eurythmics would never have achieved the level of success they did. They would have done well, but she essentially contained their success. She projected them onto the big stage.
How many sorrows do you try to hide in a world of illusion? It's covering your mind. I'll show you something good. Oh, I'll show you something good. When you open your mind, you'll discover the sign that there's something you're longing to find.
A miracle of love will take away your pain.
When I hear people tell me that I was very much the image of the Eurythmics, initially I start to get very defensive, because I think, no, I wasn't. I wasn't. We were a partnership. We were a duo. A duo that I very much intentionally wanted to present as a duo. I always try to do that. Dave, on the other hand, very much wanted it to be that I would be the front person kind of push for that. So looking back on it, it's a kind of strange dynamic of pushing and pulling, if you like. But having said all of that, the lead singer of a band, of any band, is going to be the focal point. That's the person that's singing the songs. That's the person who's looking to. And that's nothing that I can, if, you know, I say, there's nothing I can do about that. Sorry.
The sky changing to me always brings this feeling of dread. I mean, I have a real problem being, for instance, in England, which doesn't have a climate, it just has like weather. And the weather just keeps changing every 10 minutes. And so one minute you're feeling fine, and then suddenly there's a sort of a grey cloud comes over. I suppose it's like the feeling of depression.
Is it right? You didn't want to approach Isabella.
About what?
To get closer.
No, I just wanted to read her the weather, really.
Le pays, oui.
Non, ça c'est le vent.
Bon, le vent, oui.
Le pays, alors, est largement protégé.
Oui. Le pays est largement protégé par l'anticyclone centré sur la Hollande. Right?
Yeah. Right. Mm.
Et les températures de 19 à Lille et Brest, à 24 à Bordeaux, 21 à Paris et 19 à Bruxelles.
Joli.
It's funny because one of my favourite songs that Annie and I ever wrote was called Here Comes the Rain Again.
Yes.
And that song actually sums up to me the whole feeling, even though 90% of the lyrics were Annie's lyrics. I just related to it so strongly, and I think she probably does too. It's like, here comes the rain again, and it's like, uh-oh, here comes that black depression again.
Sort of exorcism of a lot of my unhappinesses, in actual fact, because I was a very, very dark soul when I was in that time, and I couldn't come to terms with things. And one way of dealing with my pain was to write it out, write it down, and all of the sort of polarizations of things that were going on, like, you know, the extremes between being immensely happy and looking towards the beauty in life, and then knowing that underneath it all was a sort of tragic undercurrent that was pulling me down. They were all encapsulated in those songs, and they were little sound bites of very intense feelings, actually.
I need you to pin me down just for one frozen moment. Someone to pin me down so I can live in torment. I need you to really feel the twist of my back breaking. I need someone to listen to the ecstasy I'm faking. I need you, you, you.
Yeah, well, gradually, as Eurythmics became successful and we did world tours and the whole paraphernalia that goes with it, and we started meeting different people and entering into different areas of our lives, that sort of psychicness or whatever of the songwriting became harder and harder, till in the end, on the last album, it was an effort. And as soon as we felt it was an effort, I think we wanted to stop it.
We fragmented, we moved, we went into other places. I mean, that sounds really odd to say it, but we sort of grew apart, and it became impossible for either of us to bear being together in a room. I mean, we couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand it, and I don't think Dave could stand it. We'd been through such a lot, and there was a lot of resentment and a lot of unexpressed rage, and there was a lot of rage that had been expressed also, but it was never quite really rounded off properly. And I think, in actual fact, when you've had to go through what Dave and I went through together, and in the end, we sort of were kind of forced together because we were this entity, and it was roller coastering, and it was like a kind of avalanche. It was getting bigger and bigger at a certain point. There was a certain degree of resentment, you know, about stepping on each other's territory. And there was a great deal of frustration also, because actually when I think back on it, it was very, from my point of view, very, very essential part of my development as a person to become an individual in my own right. It was not possible for me to grow and develop as an adult, in actual fact, until I broke away from Dave and Eurythmics. Because right up to that point, for some reason, I had always invariably thought, I can't do it without Dave, I can't do it without Dave, I'll have to ask Dave. It was almost as if I was looking to him, not as a father figure, but as somebody to give me the authority to carry out the things that I wanted to do. But I'm very grateful, you see, even though there's bad blood, there is bad blood between me and Dave, but even though there's bad blood, I know that actually the growth that's taken place between us has been extraordinary, and I'll never forget that. I'm very, very positive about that. And I have to say, I only wish Dave well, really.
When my mother and father broke up,